morning, Movement Church. We're excited to see each one of you on this Merry Christmas Eve. If you guys wouldn't mind standing and singing with us, we got a couple of Christmas songs with maybe just a little twist, so I hope you enjoy.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing.
Hey, it's Christmas, everybody. All right. Well, it's good to see all of you here this morning. For those of you that are here for the first time, my name is Jeff. I'm the lead pastor here. Very, 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 very glad that you're joining us on Christmas. I'll talk more about that in a moment. But first, if you are a first-time guest, a couple things that you need to know. If you didn't receive a gift on your way in, every first-time family has the opportunity to receive a first-time guest gift. One of the ways you can get it is by texting the word new to the number up there on the screen. What'll happen is after you send your text, we'll send you a link that you can fill out your information at. there just from your seat. And then whenever you're done filling that out, you can show that that link and show that information to our volunteers down at Connect Central on the way out, and we'll hook you up with a gift just as a way of saying thank you for joining us today. Also, if you haven't already followed us on social media, it's one of the best ways to stay connected. You can find us on Instagram as well as on Facebook. And the live stream on Facebook is up and running now. And so I want to encourage all of you that are connected with Movement Church, that call Movement Church home, go ahead and take out your phone now. Hit the share button on that live stream, because people will tune in on Christmas maybe like no other day. And so I want to encourage you to do that, because more eyes will see it, more ears will hear the gospel, and more people will get to realize what this season is really all about. Now, before we get back into worship here in just a moment, I want to tell you about something funny that happened this week, which I don't even know if they realize this happened, but there's a little nativity scene over here on this speaker, and I was up here by myself this week, and I was doing some things here in the sanctuary, and I walked over there, and I was just taking a closer look at the nativity scene, and I don't know, I don't want to draw too much attention to it, but I looked in there, and what I realized is that baby Jesus is not in that nativity scene. And I was like, oh, shoot, like, something's missing from the picture. Like, we can have the animals, we can have Mary and Joseph, we can have the wise men, we can have all of these things, but what it boils down to is that Christmas is about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, coming to earth to come and rescue us. What I was thinking as soon as I saw it, there were a couple things I was thinking, but one of them was, man, isn't that just the typical Christmas in America for a lot of people right now? And maybe you're here today because you're like, well, I just wanted to come and check out church on Christmas, but maybe a normal Christmas for you is the same way. It's got a lot of other things going on. It's very busy, but it's without Jesus. Well, I'm very, very excited to tell you today about why Jesus is the reason for the season. I'm excited to show you why that gives us such hope. So glad that you're here. We're going to continue worship. Stay standing, and let's continue to sing these songs.
may be seated. We have a little video to bring us back in the service.
All right. Listen, at Movement Church, we like a little chaos. You know what I'm saying? We'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But first of all, let me give you guys just a couple of quick announcements before we get into the message. First of all, next Sunday is New Year's Eve. We are doing something different this year. We are not going to be meeting in person. Rather, we're meeting online only. And so you can join us on our Facebook page at 11 o'clock. You can join us that way. You'll be able to interact with each other, so I encourage you to do it at 11 rather than later, because we'll be able to converse and amen and do all those good things together. And so you can stay home in your PJs next week, get rested up for whatever New Year's Eve activities that you have going on, but we're going to be online only next week. Secondly, beginning the new year, we're starting a brand new series called Rebuild. Hi, buddy. We're just starting a brand new series. It's going to be called Rebuild, and I am hyped for this one because we're going to be reading the book of Nehemiah. Listen, some of you need a fresh start in the new year. You need a fresh start. And some of you are like, well, you can start over anytime. Yeah, that's true, but you haven't, so you need a fresh start in the new year, all right? That's what this series is going to be about. It's going to challenge us to our core. It's not going to be light and fluffy and you can do it if you can dream it and all this stuff. It's going to be hardcore, focused. This is how we get recentered on God. This is how we see God rebuild our lives. So that's going to be happening in 2 weeks. Third, if you have an offering to give today, there's a couple ways that you can give it. You can either do paper or plastic money back at the cafe, if that's how you prefer, or if you prefer to use your phone, you can use the Tithely app, which you can download, or you can go to movementchurch.com/give. Let me share with you really quick two things that have happened this past week, just this past week, that your giving has been a blessing to others, two ways that your giving has been a blessing to others. First of all, some of you know that I've had the opportunity to preach to people who are in poverty over in Pakistan. It's happened twice. Some of these people are actually slaves that I've been blessed to preach through Zoom to them. And one of the things that happened is the people who run that ministry over there said, these people don't have Bibles. So they're coming to Christ, but they don't have any way of learning more about him. And so we said, well, we'll do something about it. And so we immediately donated a few hundred dollars to make sure that those people who want to follow Jesus in Pakistan can learn the word of God. Isn't that awesome? Secondly, and if you're a parent, you understand how stressful it can be this time of year buying gifts and stuff, especially if you have a lot of kids. We had a family that reached out to us where there were a handful of kids and they didn't have any way of getting Christmas presents. They thought they had a way and it fell through. I love this. I'll tell you more in a moment about why I love this. Some of you are like, this dude's nuts. I'll tell you why I love this. But we were able to bless a family. We gave them enough money to where they were able to purchase a gift for each of the kids in that family. Isn't that awesome? So that they didn't have to go without. And that was just this week. That's not counting keeping the lights on, making sure that my family's fed, all that stuff. Thank you to those of you that give faithfully. Thank you for those of you that will give today. I'm grateful for everything that comes through. It really does make a difference. And then lastly, as you'll notice, there are kids in the room today. So there's a reason for that. Today is family worship weekend. There's a couple reasons we had it today. One is because it's Christmas and we wanted to be able to worship alongside of our kids. Number two is that every single year there's our Kid Zone volunteers that often will have to sit out for our holiday events, for our holiday services. They don't get to be a part of service. In fact, if you serve in Kid Zone in any capacity, would you just stand up for a moment? Would you just stand up? These are the people who give us peace every other week. And there's more that aren't in this room. Thank you. So listen, every time you hear a noise come from a kid this morning, here's what I want you to do. Instead of getting flustered, I want you to think, thank you, Jesus, for Kid Zone. I'm serious, every single time, all right? And what I can tell you, listen, he's going to juke you. It's okay. Oh, you want to preach? Here, come here. Get back to mama. What are you doing? Hey, listen, if a kid is running to the pulpit, they got something to teach some of y'all adults, all right? That's all I'm saying. They're like, give me the word. Let's go. All right, let's take a moment and let's pray. Father God, we come to you right now. It is a privilege to be in your presence. God, with the chaos in the room, we're reminded of the fact that we are those noisy, brash, sometimes, often, actually, disobedient kids that you have to correct, but you do it with love. You chase us down when we run, and we're so grateful that you have. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would bless this very, very special Christmas Eve service that's not special because of what we bring to the table, but because your Spirit is with us, that we are not alone in this world, and because of what you've done for us. We love you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. All right. I'm going to start off today. Kids, so parents, I'm not going to talk to you. You just listen in to what I'm telling the kids. All right? Makes it easier. Kids, look at me. Nice job. I'm going to start off a Christmas service in the weirdest way ever. We're going to talk about a rock. Is that cool? Let's show this picture of this rock. All right? Isn't that nice? That's pretty cool, isn't it? No, it's not. Don't lie. Who said that? Listen, let me tell you really quick about this rock. My brother paid money to buy that rock. And you say, is your brother a dummy? Because there's a rock in my backyard where I could get one just like that and not have to pay for it. But let me tell you something. You could not find a rock just like that, most likely, in your backyard. My brother paid for that rock, and what he did is he brought it home to my parents' house. He actually gave it to my son. He brought it to my parents' house, and what he did is he took a hammer, and he took a chisel, and he tap, 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 and he made a line across the top, and he split that rock in half. And once he split the rock in half, he opened it up, and on the inside, this is what we saw. Isn't that beautiful? So that is called a geode, and it's a special kind of rock that when it's forming, a little air bubble gets in there. And when the air bubble gets in there, these minerals start to form crystals on the inside, and they can be all different colors. They come in purple and blues and pinks and greens and all kinds of things. Ours happened to be this beautiful white crystal formation. And here's why I share this with you to start off a Christmas service. When you looked at baby Jesus, listen to me. When you looked at baby Jesus, he was just a squishy, cute little stinky little baby. Like every other cute, stinky, squishy little baby. But when you look closer at who he was, that there was something incredible inside of him that you couldn't see just by looking at him. You tracking? In Isaiah says this. Look at the screen. Isaiah says this in chapter 9. He says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given." Well, what's so special about a little kid? What's so special about a little baby? Well, he continues. "The government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this." Jesus was no ordinary baby. No ordinary baby. There was more to him than meets the eye. And the Christmas story teaches us the things about Jesus that we can't see just by looking at that little baby in the manger. So today we're going to see, what is it that the Christmas story can teach us about the things that we can't see? So here's the first thing. And parents, I told you short and engaging, so that's what we're going for, all right? The Christmas story, the first thing is this, the Christmas story teaches us about Jesus' identity. By the way, let me pause for a second. If you're a kid, you should have a piece of paper. Do you have your papers that we passed out? Hold it up, okay? Fill that out. If you fill that out all the way and you fill it out right, because you're listening to me, at the end of the service, you can take that back to the cafe and you can pick a prize out of our prize basket. All right, so give me your focus. All right, that's what it looks like. If you have that sheet, make sure you fill that out, okay? All right, so listen, the Christmas story teaches us about Jesus' identity. And an identity is what a person is or who they are. So how many of you like superheroes? Raise your hand. Yep, me too. Okay, so here's a question. A lot of superheroes have these secret identities or ways of pretending like they're somebody so that nobody discovers who they really are. So let's test your superhero knowledge, all right? If you know who the superhero is, I want you to yell it out to me. You ready? So who is Peter Parker? Spider-Man. Right. So Peter Parker is Spider-Man, and Spider-Man is Peter Parker. How about this one? Let's try this one. Who is Clark Kent? Superman, that's right. How about this one? Who's Bruce Wayne? Batman. All right, this one's a little bit more challenging for some of us. You ready? Who is Diana Prince? Wonder Woman, nice job, you got it. So, all of those superheroes looked normal, right? On the outside, until they put on their costume and they showed off their powers. Well, Jesus is very much the same way. In John chapter 1, this is what John says about him. He says, "In the beginning was the Word." The Word is a nickname for Jesus, so he's talking about Jesus. Listen. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." All right, kids, you ready? This is your first thing you're going to write on your paper. Here it comes. It's going to go up on the screen. Jesus was born, but he did not begin on Christmas because he is God. Josh, you can just leave that up there for a second. Jesus was born on Christmas, but he didn't begin on Christmas. You and I, we began in our mommy's bellies. But that's not how Jesus was. Jesus is God, so he's always existed all the way into eternity past. The Old Testament says that his origins are from of old, is the way it describes it. And so he was born on Christmas. He became human on Christmas, But he didn't begin on Christmas. We have a special word for this. It's incarnation, and it means in flesh. God became flesh. He took on a human body. And here's what this means for us. Because God became a baby, it means that God is not far from us. Do you know how many stars roughly are in the Milky Way galaxy where we live? Take a guess. Go ahead, Micah, guess. 20 billion? Ethan? 60 billion? Yes, I don't know your name. What do you think? 9 billion? There's roughly 100 billion stars in our galaxy. Now, ready for this? How many galaxies do scientists think are in our universe, Grayson? Okay, more than 100, that's true. Knox? 1,000 to 10,000, AJ? Some scientists estimate that there are 2 trillion with a T galaxies in our universe. In our galaxy alone, there's 100 billion stars. And here's the amazing thing. You ready for this? The God who made all of it chose to come to the little speck of dust that we call Earth so that he could be close to you. Come on, isn't that awesome? Because Jesus came close, he's Emmanuel, God with us, it means that he wants to be close regardless of how we feel. Even when we feel he's far away, he's never far at all. And that's good news for us. It also means that because Jesus is God, we shouldn't just admire him, that we should worship him, that we should love him with all of our heart and give him all of our allegiance and trust everything that he says, because he's not just an, you can leave him if you want. As long as you're cool, I'm cool. He's doing great up here. We don't just admire Jesus, that we should actually worship him. In the Bible, did you know that nobody is supposed to be worshiped other than God himself? And yet Jesus accepts worship. Because he's God in the flesh. And so there's more to baby Jesus than meets the eye. And the Christmas story teaches us about Jesus' identity. Here's the second one. The Christmas story teaches us about Jesus' character. I want to show you character, by the way, for you kids that don't know what that means. It means, what is he like? Now we know who he is. He's God. But what is he like? And I got a picture for you of a horse that is just absolutely huge. Look at that big fella. That's a big horse. Now listen to me. I've seen a horse that big. He lives down in Amish country, and he has a really cool name. His name is Big Ben. Let me tell you about Big Ben. Big Ben is 7 feet tall and 3,000 pounds. That means that some of you, the car that you drove in here in today, that car weighs as much as that horse. He is a big, big horse. And I tell you, when you walk up to Big Ben, and I'm 6 feet tall almost, but when I walk up to Big Ben, I feel like a little baby. I'm like, oh my goodness, this thing could just crush me if it wanted to. But you know what he does instead? All day long, Big Ben just stands there and takes pictures with visitors and lets people pet him on the nose. That's all he does. He's huge. No, listen, this is important. He's huge and he's powerful, but he's gentle. And I want you to see that Jesus is the same way. When the angel came to Mary to tell her that she would have a baby, we read in Luke 1 that this is what the angel said to her. The angel said, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus." Listen to this. "He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." And so again, this squishy little baby is actually a mighty king. And so, kids, for those of you that are following along with your activity sheet, this is the next section you need to write on. Jesus is gentle, but he is also mighty. Jesus is gentle, but he is also mighty. We see this in the Christmas story. He's placed in a manger. He's humble. He seems very innocent and even fragile, doesn't he? A baby's kind of fragile. I used to be scared to hold babies because I didn't want to drop them or hurt them. But Jesus is also mighty. He's powerful. He's the ruler. He's strong. Some people will try to tell you that he's one or the other. Some people will tell you that Jesus is gentle, but he's not a ruler, he's not a king. And here's why they probably do that. Because they really like that Jesus is forgiving and that he heals people, but they don't like that he tells them what to do. You hear me? They like that Jesus is gentle because he's approachable, but they don't like when he says, you need to follow me, you need to obey me because I'm your king. There's other people who like that he's powerful, but they don't like that he's gentle. And a lot of times, those people are people who think way too highly of themselves. They think, I'm not really that bad of a person. I know the Bible says that we're all sinners, but there are way worse sinners than me. And so they say, I'm glad that Jesus is strong because he's going to set all them straight one day. And they don't realize that they need his gentleness. They need his forgiveness. I want to tell you this morning that the Christmas story teaches us that Jesus leverages his gentleness and his strength and his love to benefit us. Because he's gentle, that means we can go to him even when we've messed up. No matter how far you've run, no matter what mistakes you've made, no matter how long you've been going away from him, it means that you can go right back to him the second that you're ready to turn back. And it gets better than that. Because if he wasn't also mighty, if he wasn't also a ruler, it would mean that we could go to him, but he couldn't really help us. But because he's strong, not only can we go to him, but we know that he has the strength to save us as well. Praise God that Jesus is gentle, but also mighty. And so the Christmas story teaches us about Jesus' character. And then the last thing for this morning is that the Christmas story teaches us about Jesus' purpose for coming. I want to show you a picture about a beautiful place in the United States, believe it or not. That's called Maui. And that's an island of Hawaii. Isn't that beautiful? How many of you have ever been to Hawaii? Put your hands down. You're making us mad. I'm just kidding. But look, that's the island of Maui. Isn't it beautiful? So you want to hear something crazy? For those of you that give regularly here, one of the things that you may not know is that in November, your giving helps send a handful of people, Ohio Baptists, to Maui. And some of you are like, wait a minute. Is this one of those church scandal things? Are we funding vacations and private jets? No. See, what happened is we sent a handful of people to Maui, not because it looks like this, but because it looks like this. Listen to me. Some of you know that this year the island of Maui had wildfires that spread and that destroyed homes and cars and even took lives. And so in November, Ohio Baptist sent a handful of people to Maui, not to vacation. That wasn't their purpose for being there. Not to just enjoy the sights, but they were sent there as an ash out team. And their job was to go in and to help people who had lost almost everything in those fires to recover some of the things that were special to them. And you guys helped fund that. So yeah, you can applaud for that. That's really awesome. And when I think about their purpose for going there, it perfectly reflects the reason that Jesus came here for us. That Jesus didn't come to earth because he thought, I need a vacation from the paradise that is heaven. No, he came to recover that which was lost. Namely, us, our souls. We were lost. We were broken. We were hopeless. And Jesus said, I see you struggling in the darkness. Let me come and bring some light to your life. That's what Jesus has done. We read this in Matthew chapter 1. We read the account of an angel appearing to Mary to tell her what was going to happen, but we haven't yet read the account of what the angel said to Joseph. And so we read this in Matthew chapter 1. It says, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, listen to this, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Listen, this is the last one on your sheets, kids. Jesus came to save his people from their sins. It wasn't a vacation. It wasn't just to make us feel good inside. It was to rescue us from ourselves. It was to rescue us from ourselves, to bring light to those in darkness, to give life to the dead and hopeless, to seek and to save the lost. The name Jesus actually means the Lord saves. And I will not add to the scriptures, because that would be wrong, but if I was told to, I would add the word only in there. Only the Lord saves. He alone can do what he did for us on the cross. It says Jesus saves from our sins. Sin happens in two ways in our lives, by doing things that the Lord has said are wrong and by not doing things that he has said are right. Every single one of us have sinned and have no way of fixing it ourselves. We can't undo the things that we've done against God. And so Jesus came. He sacrificed himself on the cross. He paid the penalty that our sins deserve. He was dead, he was buried, and then he resurrected on the third day to prove that his purchase for us, that his dying for us was effective, that it actually worked, and that he sits on the throne and he reigns today. Think about this for a second. One of the things that makes Christmas so special is that it was the first step for Jesus in going to the cross. Because unless he had a body, he couldn't die. And unless he died, he couldn't die for our sins in our place. And so Christmas is this amazing thing where we get to see the first step in our salvation, God becoming man, taking on human life so that he could give that life for the rest of us. Isn't that beautiful? That is beautiful, man. So this Christmas, I want you to know that this Christmas story and all these amazing things about Jesus aren't told so that you would just have a happy holiday and that you would feel good for this season and then you would forget it the rest of the year. All of these things, these prophecies, these miracles, these angels appearing, are shared with us that we might trust him for the salvation of our souls, for the changing of our eternity, not so we might just enjoy a Christmas service together. And so that's the call this morning. Jesus is no longer a baby, church. He's got the scars to prove that he paid for your sins, but now you must trust him yourself. Why don't you stand? We're going to worship with one more song. But before we do that, I want to pray with all of you. You kids have been absolutely wonderful. I'm so grateful for you. But if you could just bow your head and close your eyes, we're going to pray together first. And I'm going to extend the opportunity to you, as I do pretty much every week. If there's somebody in this room this morning that has not yet put their faith in Jesus and trusted him for the forgiveness of their sins, I just want you to know that there's no better time than now. Jesus gave his life for you so that you could have eternal life. Yes, he is a king. Yes, he has commands. Yes, there are things to follow, but his commands are not burdensome because they're not like the other things in your life that have dragged you down. They're there to pick you up. They're there to make you more like him. And if you're here this morning and you say, you know what? I haven't trusted Jesus, but I need to trust in Jesus for the forgiveness of my sins, and I'm ready to do that now. If that's you, while everybody's heads are bowed, everybody's eyes are closed, I want to pray for you. So would you just put your hand up in the air as a way of just saying, that's me. I want to trust him right now. Is there anybody here who's ready to put their faith in Jesus this morning for the first time? I see you, sweetie. I see you, bud. Jesus wasn't shy when he was publicly humiliated and tortured for you. Don't be shy now. Is there anybody else who's ready to give their life to Christ today? To begin afresh, all over again? See you, buddy. Praise God. Let's pray together. Father God, I thank you so much for this Christmas, the celebration of what you did 2,000 years ago, taking the first step where you didn't expect us to meet you halfway because we couldn't because of our sin. Instead, you said, I'm going to come all the way down to them so that I can lift them and bring them all the way up to where I want them to be. I thank you for these young ones today who said, I'm ready to trust him. I pray that that faith, that childlike faith, would never leave them, even though they'll grow and they'll learn and they'll mature and they'll become more like you. I pray that they would always trust you and always lean on you and always believe. Father, I'm so thankful that you can change us for eternity right now. I'm so thankful for your coming. I'm so thankful for your sacrifice. And Lord Jesus, I pray that for all of us here that believe, that this Christmas thing, this incarnation, God with us, would be something that would be lightning to our hearts every single day of the year, but especially during this season. That through every difficulty, we can know that God has not left us alone. The one who made 2 trillion galaxies chose to come here to be with me. And that one day he will take us to be forever with him. We love you, Lord. I pray that this remaining time of worship would be honoring to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together.
The song that church, sing this out with us. You turn morning to dancing.
You turn morning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the
monster. All right. Hey, listen, really quick, just a couple things before I dismiss you. First of all, thank you for joining us. Listen, Christmas is something we need to be celebrating all year round. Make sure you're back here next week online. Make sure you're back here in 2 weeks for our New Year service. I'm telling you, it's going to be awesome. Second thing, if you are a kid and you filled out your sheet, make sure you take it back to the cafe before you leave so you can pick a prize out of the basket. Thirdly, if you haven't taken the opportunity to give and you're planning on it, don't forget to do that. I love you guys. Merry Christmas, and we'll see you in the new year. All right? Merry Christmas, guys. Thank you.